All right. Thank you for coming, everyone. My name is Leah Webb, and I'm the author of the Grain-Free, Sugar-Free, Dairy-Free Family Cookbook. I did bring some copies that are available for sale if you want to check those out before you leave. And I am going to be presenting on belly biochemistry. This is a really fun talk for me, and it's also one that really hits home for me. So some of you know me and you know a little bit about my story, but these are my two kids, Owen and June. And when Owen was born, we pretty quickly realized that he had a variety of food issues. He was an extremely sensitive child, and then as we started introducing foods, he had anaphylactic responses to a variety of foods. And this was despite my efforts to really take care of myself as a mother who, you know, was bearing this child in her womb. He was just born this way. He was born with some issues. And then when my daughter was born, we found out that she had cystic fibrosis when she was about 2 weeks old. For those who don't know what cystic fibrosis is, it's a genetic disease that impacts the lungs and pancreas. And so for her entire life, she will pretty heavily depend on antibiotics. There's no way around that. You can't eat your way out of a genetic disease. That's just the way it goes. So I have these two kids that both have these kind of limitations when it comes to immunity. So my daughter is needing frequent antibiotics to keep her lungs healthy. She can't fight off infections in the same way that you or I can. And we all know now that antibiotics really wipe out this beneficial population that resides in your gut. It's best not to use hand sanitizers and antimicrobial soaps and antibiotics, which are things we've been doing for a long time. But this is just going to be part of her life. And then with my son, I mean, an allergy and asthma, this is an overactive immune response. And so I was looking for ways to be able to better support them. But the unfortunate truth is that my family is not alone in these issues. If you look at the CDC, what you'll see is that, this is directly from their website, is that 6 in 10 adults has a chronic disease. And to be honest, I think this is underreporting because a lot of people, there's no actual diagnosis for what they have. And I think unless they can fit you into a category, it's really hard to report whatever condition you have. 4 in 10 adults has 2 or more chronic diseases. 46% of children has a chronic disease. This is primarily asthma and allergies, other types of lung diseases. 1 in 30 children has autism. The projections for autism are pretty astounding. If we keep at the rate of increase that we're at, there's been a scientist at MIT, I believe, who published a study saying that if we don't change something about what we're doing, and there's not a lot of agreement as to why autism is on the rise as much as it is, but they have predicted that 1 in 3 children will have autism by 2025, which is in the pretty near future. I should also note this person has been highly criticized. So I would not necessarily say that this is true, but I'm just saying that if we continue at this rate, you know, I mean, if you think about the economic burden of having this many children with a mental disability, this is could have a big impact on our economy. And then 1 in 13 children with allergies. I manage a after-school cooking club at my son's elementary school. We have 24 kids in that program, and 3 of them show up with EpiPens. So when you see these numbers, it's hard to understand that these are real people that are experiencing these effects. Mental health isn't much better. 1 in 5 adults experiences a mental illness every single year. 1 in 6 children experience a mental illness. Suicide is the 2nd leading cause of death for people between the ages of 10 and 34. So it's even happening sometimes with people who are doing the things to prevent the devastation of disease. But if you look at worldwide data, it boils down to 4 lifestyle risk factors that are responsible for the majority of preventable chronic disease. And those 4 lifestyle risk factors are diet, smoking, lack of exercise, and excessive alcohol consumption. Now, there was a study published in April of last year that was an analysis of the Global Burden of Disease study. And what this study looked at was what are the dietary reasons that people are experiencing such problems, that we have such high rates of chronic illness. And one of the interesting things from this study, so what they did is this was a 27-year study looking at dietary patterns of 195 countries. So this is a big study. I mean, this is not just a little blip in time where they're trying to figure out what's going on. But the interesting thing that they found was that it wasn't necessarily that we're eating too many trans fats or that we're having too many omega-6s, but they documented that it's a lack of these foods right here that are responsible for causing chronic illness. So what do you see when I show you this picture?
Just real food?
Yeah. This is just food, right? Like, if I was to go to the grocery store and buy ingredients to cook my own meals, these are the types of things that I would come home with. We're not coming home with those things in our shopping carts. And so this is where this study was pointing to the problem, is that it's not necessarily the bad things that we're eating, it's our lack of healthy things that we're eating. The number one factor was actually diets that were high in sodium. And so I am not, I use a lot of salt when I cook, but there is still a difference in the way that salt, in when I season it with salt, than if I'm eating something packaged. I mean, my family isn't doing this 100%. We eat some packaged processed foods as well. But when I do eat those foods, you know, you can tell how thirsty you are. And I think it's because those foods are so high in sodium. So this was just a really interesting study that also was interesting because they said that diet has now surpassed smoking as the number one lifestyle risk factor associated with chronic preventable disease. So what I would like to talk about today is to, you know, I've already kind of outlined this issue around disease and where it is that we stand as a nation and why it is that we have reason for concern. And so I'd kind of like to trace you through, starting with the soil, and this, I'm going to actually do this backwards, just because it'll make more sense in the long run. But what my objective is to talk about how the soil is going to impact the quality of the food that you consume, and then how that food is going to affect your microbiome, and how your microbiome is going to affect your outcome for disease. So let me know if you have questions throughout, or we can just answer them at the end. I will allow about 15 minutes so that I can get your questions then as well. So I think we should start by talking about how digestion actually works so that we can understand the role of the microbes in this system. So digestion is going to start in your mouth. If you think about food in this large sense, this is not a usable form of nutrition for your body. Your body's objective is to take that usable food and break it down into smaller and smaller parts until it's a nutrient that can be assimilated and used in your body. So when you start chewing, that starts that whole process. You have digestive enzymes that are in your saliva, your teeth are grinding your food down, and then it's going to make its way into the stomach, into the small intestines, and then lastly into the colon before it's excreted. Now, if you think about if you've just chewed your food, so that's where you've started the process, and now you're basically going to take that food and drop it into an acid bath in your stomach. If you guys can remember back from Chemistry 101, however many years ago that was, longer for some of you, shorter for others. But if you remember your pH scale, pH of 0 is going to be extremely acidic. That's where you're going to have sulfuric acid. pH of 14 is going to be extremely basic. So if you look right up here, stomach acid is at a pH of 1. So this is extremely acidic. This is a mechanism in place to start to break that food down further in order to extract the usable pieces of nutrition from it. But then after moving into the stomach, that's where you're going to meet your small intestines. So your small intestines is this network of folds and creases. The lining of your intestines has villi and microvilli. On the villi, there's glycolysis. All of these digestive enzymes are being excreted from your pancreas into your small intestines. This is a really complicated system that is trying to break these pieces further and further down. So it's kind of using a physical mechanism. You have all these, you know, these folds and creases, and there's movement going on in there too. So, and then with the enzymes, the digestive enzymes too, that's starting to break that food down further. So your intestines are about 20 feet long. If you did not have all of these folds and creases and villi and microvilli and digestive cells, they would have to be about 4.5 miles long. So if you can think about trying to cram that into your stomach, we better be thankful for all of those things that are in place. And then what also starts to happen in the small intestines is that some particles become usable nutrition. and they start to get absorbed into the bloodstream and into the lymph, where they can be delivered throughout the body to fuel your cells. Now, what also happens is there is this filtration system that's happening. It's called gut permeability, and I'll talk a little bit more about that. And this system is in place to keep the things inside the gut that are not yet usable and let the other things out that are usable. So the things that are not yet usable, that the small intestines are not able to break them down, they then move into the colon. And this is where your microbial magic is going to happen. You have about 10 times more bacteria and microbes that reside in your colon than you do in your small intestines. So there are some microbes that are at work in your small intestines, but primarily the work is your own body, your own mechanisms are at work in that section of your digestive tract. The structure of your colon is going to be different as well. This is a long, hollow tube. It's about 5 feet long. And these microbes, they can digest things that you can't. And so a couple of things happens as a result. So for one, you get byproducts. I mean, as a result of being alive, you have metabolic byproducts that are released from your body. We have carbon dioxide and pheromones and sweat. I mean, there are things that are coming out of our bodies. Bacteria are no different. There is no living organism that is not releasing some type of metabolite as a result of being alive. So when these bacteria are releasing these metabolites, some of them are things like vitamin B12 or vitamin K or short-chain fatty acids that help to reduce inflammation in the gut and can help in the healing process. These are things that you can't get that nutrition from your food without using these microbes. So they're really valuable. So to carry on, I want to make three assumptions about digestion. And these are just things that I've made up. This is not something you're going to find in a textbook or anything like that. But it's just to further explain this process. Number one is that to assume you have healthy digestion, your body's own digestive mechanisms need to be in proper working order. So that means you need to be chewing, you need to have digestive enzymes in your saliva, you need to have appropriate pH levels in your stomach, your villi are working, they haven't been compromised in any way, which can happen with diseases like celiac. Your bile is flowing. All of these different pieces need to be in working order. I'm not going to talk any more about that today. just that you would assume that your body is working. The other two are issues that I am going to briefly talk about. And so number two would be that you have a proper discrimination and filtration of particles in the gut. So that gut lining, the integrity of that lining, is keeping things in that are not yet usable and letting things out that are usable. And I'll show you a visual of this in just a second. And lastly, that you do have a healthy microbial population that does exist within the colon. All right, so what happens when number two goes wrong? So this second issue that can happen, you can have gut permeability that goes wrong. So in your gut, you have these tight junctions between cells. And there are different things that can degrade these tight junctions to allow particles to slip through that shouldn't be slipping through. This is a bit of a chicken and the egg type situation because these list of issues that I have here can be caused from leaky gut, or they can cause leaky gut. Did I say that right? So chicken and the egg, it's hard to determine what's going on. But what happens is you end up having these particles, whether it be a toxin, a food particle, a pathogen, that seeps into the bloodstream or into the lymph where it's not supposed to be. And when you have something in your body that's not supposed to be there, your body recognizes that as an antigen, and it elicits an immune response. It sends an attack. It tries to protect you from this foreign invader that has made its way into your body where it's not supposed to be. So this immune response, in most instances, this is a desirable response. I mean, this is how you heal wounds, and you can, if you have an injury, this inflammation response, it will help to heal you. But when you have a constant inflow of these antigens that are always getting into your bloodstream that aren't supposed to be there, what you have is low-grade systemic inflammation. And that's where you can start to develop these different types of itises. So these itises are just an inflammatory response. So things like diverticulitis, colitis, arthritis. You know, these are signs and symptoms that there is systemic inflammation in the body. So your body can respond in a number of different ways. You can have IgG immune response, IgA, IgE, T cells can be involved. This is something I do like to note because IgE-mediated responses are a true allergy. So I think we overuse this word allergy now. Sensitivities and intolerances are often a more appropriate word to use for these things. And the reason that I say that is because my son has a true anaphylactic allergy, and it is very hard to communicate that to people because that word is used incorrectly so often. And so I do just kind of like to bring that point up. But if you have leaky gut, and has anyone heard of that term? Is it a new term for anyone? Okay, I also think this is interesting because if you look at the, I think it, whatever the governing body is over gastrology, they say that leaky gut is actually not a real condition, but then they also talk about gut permeability and how you can have a lack of permeability or too much permeability. So to me, the two sound pretty much the same. But this, I mean, I think this is a great term to describe what it is that's happening. But it can cause or be caused from hormone imbalance, stress, autoimmune disease, colitis, toxins, pathogenic microbes, food intolerances, or food allergies. So when you start to identify what the offensive problem is, you really want to get that out of your diet as much as you can to allow some healing to take place. So now I want to spend more time talking about number three, which is that you do have this healthy microbial population that resides in your colon, and that it's not making its way up into your small intestines where it's not supposed to be, and that you actually have the right number of species and the right types of organisms in there. So is anyone familiar with the Human Microbiome Project? I know everyone knows about the Human Genome Project, which happened first, and it turned out that we're not nearly as sophisticated as we had hoped. I don't think we're even as sophisticated as a fruit fly. I believe that's correct. Does anyone remember this? We were really disappointed to find out that we're not that complex genetically. But the Human Microbiome Project, what they did is it started in 2008, and they were trying to document, they're trying to identify which microbes were in and on the human body, and then whether or not those populations could be related to some type of health outcome. And so one of the interesting things that they found was that, and I've seen different numbers for this, so I'll present the range, is that your body is only half human, the other half is bacteria. And so some estimates say that you have 10 times as many bacterial cells on your body as you have human cells. Other estimates say it's more like 1-to-1. Whatever it is, it's very clear that we are a mutualistic organism with microbes. We have some type of symbiosis going on with them where we need them for something. So with this human and the other thing that they found out was that you have 100 times more microbial DNA on your body than you do human DNA. So some of this DNA is coding for things like digestive enzymes and performing functions that are necessary for you to live, but you wouldn't be able to perform those functions without those associations with your microbes. So if you get on their website, they have linked different signature populations to different outcomes. The three that they've focused on are onset of inflammatory bowel disease, pregnancy and preterm birth, and onset of type 2 diabetes. And so this is all open source information. You can go to their website and find out more. It's not necessarily very easy to understand, I will warn you. It's not very easy to navigate either. But if you look into the literature, what you'll find is that the Human Microbiome Project has only focused on these three areas of research, but there are researchers all over the country that are looking at the microbial population in your gut and what other health outcomes can we make the association between those bacteria or those fungi and disease outcome. And so I have just listed a fraction of what you can find in the literature. So I've got violent behavior, cancers, heart disease, depression, Alzheimer's, Parkinson's, spectrum disorders, autism, inflammatory bowel disease, irritable bowel syndrome, obesity, type 2 diabetes, non-alcoholic liver disease, alcoholic liver disease, atherosclerosis, and metabolic syndrome. So one of the things that stands out to me is that oftentimes when you start talking about microbes and digestion, people automatically assume that the impacts are going to be on your digestion. It's going to be a localized effect. But if you look at this list of diseases, these impact the brain as well. So this is not just limited to damage within your gut and the way that your gut responds. This is expanding into how it is that your brain operates. And to me, that's pretty astounding that these bacteria and these microbes can have that type of control over the human body. So this is normally when people start wondering what's in their poop. And so you can get a comprehensive stool testing done from Genova Diagnostics, and this actually happens to be based in Asheville. And what they will do is you will mail them 3 days worth of your feces, and then they will analyze it and tell you exactly what they have found in there. And then they also will give you a printout telling you whether or not some of the things that they have found can be linked to IBD or colitis, type 2 diabetes, metabolic syndrome, chronic fatigue, high blood pressure, or mood disorders. So whether or not your insurance will pay for this, I have no idea. Sometimes it depends on how it was ordered, who ordered it, whether or not there's a code for it. I mean, there are all these different things that I cannot tell you. I think that if you decide to do this on your own, I think it's around $600 that if you want to get this analysis. But it can be extremely valuable if you have been experiencing some type of health issue that you just really can't find an answer to otherwise. So now let's talk about how it is that these microbes are impacting an organ such as your brain and how it is that they are having this systemic effect on your body rather than just a localized effect. And so it's possible through something called bidirectional communication, and I'm not going to get too in-depth with this for two reasons. One, I think it's irrelevant because I think that we really just need to understand the basic concept of how this works in order to apply it in our lives. And then the second reason is because I don't actually understand it beyond what I'm going to explain today. Because in order to do that, I would have to understand these specific neurotransmitters and much more in depth than I think that I'm willing to go with this. But the way this works is that you have your brain communicating with the gut communicating with the brain, the gut communicating with microbes, microbes communicating with the gut, and the microbes communicating with brain, and brain with the microbes. So this is happening through your nervous system. You've heard has anyone heard the gut called the second brain? And it's because there are so many nerves in your gut, and there's more nerves sending messages to your brain than there are your brain sending messages to your gut. So your gut is really kind of in charge in this situation is the way that it seems. So your nervous system is involved, and then you also have your lymph system, which is going to be your immune system. So that's some of the signaling that's happening in here. And then you also have your endocrine system, which is going to be your system of hormones. So you can see why this gets really complicated quickly, because you're talking about a system of neurotransmitters, hormones, and immune cells. So that's why I can't explain it beyond what I'm explaining today. But what is also interesting about this is that this communication can either be localized in that the microbes, as a result of them being a living organism, they are excreting metabolites as a process of being alive. These metabolites can have a direct impact in the gut, where that signal, that nervous signal, can then be messaged to the brain, or they can produce compounds that can get into the blood, travel to the brain, cross the blood-brain barrier, and actually have an impact that way as well. So then you start to see that there are things like insulin resistance and fat deposition and metabolism, that these are actually largely controlled by the bacteria that you find in your gut and those other microbes. So really complicated system, but also really interesting because it shows you the power that these bacteria can have over your mind and over all of these different functions that are happening with your body. So they are a really essential part of your health. Does anybody have any questions about that before I move on? Great.